verse was taken, or that song was taken out of Psalm 52, or 32. Thou art my hiding place. Thou shalt compass me with songs of deliverance. Isn't it just fantastic that we have a Savior that we don't have to worry about what's going on in our life? He's there for us. Okay, on this next song, I'm going to have to pin strictly on the screen. My song is gone. Thursday night got late. You got Peace Like a River? Okay. You know, those late night hours, sometimes they catch up to you. Let's all stand. When we have Jesus in our heart and we know we can give everything to Him, He gives us that peace. I've got peace like a river.
I'm not afraid. Thank you, Cindy. You know, music always plays an important part in our lives. And throughout history, whether it's choral music or it's just instrumental, it can be used as a powerful communication tool. A powerful tool that expresses a wide range of emotions. Those from disappointment to gratitude, from excitement to despair. And oftentimes, music is a reflection of an internal attitude that reveals the truth of where our heart is. It reveals the truth of what we believe. And for us as believers, music is a form of worship that can be used to reveal the truth of who God is, what His true character, His true nature is. And it communicates it in such a way that we are appreciative for what He has done and the fact that our hope is found in no one else. Music is a very powerful tool. Music is something that we grow up learning. We grow up in various ways. And the Apostle Paul tells us in Philippians chapter 3 that the ones who worship by the Spirit of God boast in Christ Jesus and do not put confidence in the flesh. Those who worship by the Spirit of God. You know, as Christians, our hope is found in the Lord. He is our rock, our redeemer. See, when you try to speak too fast, those words kind of combine. He is our rock and our redeemer, and He never fails us. We learn this by the teaching and the reading of His word. We learn this by songs that we experienced growing up. How many of you ever were taught, "Jesus loves me, this I know"? Don't worry, I'm not going to sing for you this morning. But "Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so." Or, "He's got the whole world in His hands." Songs that were taught to us as young kids that revealed biblical truths to us to help us understand theological truths, to teach us about the sovereign and power of God in a very fun and exciting way, and to remind us that above all else, our God loves us and protects us, and He is there for us no matter what. You know, in our life, we can face so many trials. We face struggles on a daily basis. We face mountains and hills that we have to conquer. We face valleys that we have to go through. And it's an important reminder to us when we think back on these songs, when we think back on God's word, of the fact that God is with us every step of the way. What a wonderful, wonderful Jesus. The fact that He is there with us should give us all the confidence in the world to take the next step in life. This morning, we're going to look at another form of song. It's one that the ancient Israelites would sing, and it was meant to calm their fears. It was meant to remind them of who their God is. Psalm 121 is where we're going to be at this morning. So if you'll turn in your Bibles with me to Psalm 121. And it's known as a song of ascent. There's a group of these psalms that are known as songs of ascent. And what it's meant to do is to help focus our minds and prepare our hearts for worshiping God. The ancient Israelites would sing these various songs to each other as they went about their travel to Jerusalem to remind them that even though they may face danger along the way, they had nothing to fear because God was always with them. You know, it's an important reminder for us today because we live our lives surrounded by so much anxiety and fear over what we see and hear in the news, over what we see and hear in social media. And my prayer is that as we read through our text this morning, that we can find some comfort in knowing that no matter what we're facing today, God is with us because we are part of God's family. And there's nothing that this world has to offer that's more powerful than God. I don't know what you're going through in this moment. Maybe you're going through a hard time in your life. Maybe you're going through a tough decision that you have to make. Maybe you're going through a painful experience. Maybe you're going through a painful loss. Maybe you're going through an illness. I don't know what is in your heart right now, but God does. And trust me when I say that none of that is more powerful than God. God is more powerful than anything we're going through right now. Let's read through Psalm 121 together this morning as we begin. It says, I lift my eyes toward the mountains. Where will my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to slip. Your protector will not slumber. Indeed, the protector of Israel does not slumber or sleep. The Lord protects you. The Lord is a shelter right by your side. The sun will not strike you by day or the moon by night. The Lord will protect you from all harm. He will protect your life. The Lord will protect your coming and going, both now and forever. The ancient Israelites would sing songs like this as they were on their way to Jerusalem, which is where the temple was. And the road to Jerusalem was filled with multiple dangers. We read over in the passage of the Good Samaritan about how on the journey, this man beaten and left to dead. It's on this road to Jerusalem that this takes place. There are robbers hiding nearby, ready to attack the people as they pass. The desert sun is beating down on top of you. It's hot. It's miserable. But you lift your eyes towards the hills because Jerusalem is built up on a hill. It's built up on a mountaintop. So the elevation is higher. So in order to get to Jerusalem, you have to go up. Well, as you're going up, the path gets narrower. As the path gets narrower, dangers increase. You've got robbers standing by. You've got the sun. You've got the cliffs that you could slip off of. You've got the winding path. You never know what's around the next curve. You know, I was told early on when we got here that Thompsonville sits up on a hill. Miss Ruthie was telling me about that. She said, have you ever noticed as you come into Thompsonville, you're going up? And I thought, no, I've never really noticed that. I should start paying attention when I drive. I don't know. But I never noticed it's up in an elevation. But if you're coming from West Frankfort and you're driving up, yeah, you got a little bit of this that you go, but you're constantly in an elevation. You're constantly sitting up on a hill. Those little valleys that we go through are kind of a reminder in our life that there are valleys. We go through times of despair. We go through times of danger. We go through times of illness. We go through times of desperation. But ultimately, if we keep our eyes on the hills, we keep our eyes on Christ, we can get through those valleys. It's when you focus on the danger in front of you that you lose your footing. It's when you lose sight of who you truly are. The Israelites are singing this song. I look up to the mountains. Some translations will say the hills, where the danger is, and asking the question, where does my help come from? It's a question that a lot of people are asking today. Because if you turn on the news, if you go onto social media, if you just have conversations with people, you're going to see the evil and craziness in this world. And people are asking, who's going to protect us? Who's going to redeem us? Who's going to keep us safe from this crazy, evil, broken world that we live in? Who's going to keep us safe from all these crazy political decisions that are being made and what our future looks like? Who's going to save us and provide the resources that we need from the disasters that we experience in life, like the chemical spill that happened out in Ohio and various other places around our country? Who's going to save us? Who's going to redeem us? Who's going to rescue us? Who's going to provide these resources? Where does my help come from? As Christians, as believers, we know exactly where our help comes from. It comes from God and no one else. Because God does provide for his children. It may not be in the ways that we expect it. It may not be in the ways that we think we need it. But he will provide. Right away in verse 2, they give the answer to their question. The one who is sovereign over all creation. That's where my help comes from. It comes from the Lord. The Israelites are being reminded of who they are and who they worship. And there is nothing in them to fear in creation because they have an intimate relationship with the Creator. You know, that's something that Jesus refers to over in the book of Matthew chapter 10 when he says, don't fear those who kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul. Rather, fear him who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. You know, in our society today, we have a lot of things that can take our focus off of Christ. We have a lot of things that can cause fear to dwell up inside of us. And when we put our trust, our hope, our faith in our own selfish self-desires, our abilities, in the things that we can accomplish, this fear begins to cripple us. And Satan's grasp starts to tighten. However, when we put our faith and our hope and our trust in Christ and accept him as our Lord and Savior, trusting in him and in him alone, Satan's grasp starts to weaken. Because the fear doesn't hold us back. We keep our eyes to the hills. We keep our eyes to the mountains. We keep our eyes on Christ and on him alone. And there's nothing that can knock us out of whack. Nothing that can take us off. Theologian Charles Spurgeon put it this way. The great cause of a Christian's distress, the reason of the depths of sorrow into which many believers are plunged, is simply this. That while they are looking about on the right hand and on the left to see how they may escape their troubles, they forget to look to the hills from where all real help comes. God is our sovereign creator, but he is also our caring and loving Savior. You know, Drew and I, we've always loved to go hiking. Every chance we get, we go find a trail. Sometimes that leads us into trouble. One time in California, we decided, we'll go for a hike while Christy and her mom went shopping. Little did we know, we probably should have had a map along with us because we get out on this trail and we get lost. And we're thinking, oh, well, if we turn left here, that's the exit. No. Well, if we turn right here, maybe that's the way. And then we finally see somebody coming over a hill. And we said, how far do we need to go before we get to the end of the trail? And they said, oh, it's just over the hill. You know, some people's interpretations is different than others. Because it was over that hill and over the next hill and around a couple of curves. And then there was another hill. At some point, Drew and I decided, you know what, we're going to turn around and walk back because we know the direction we came. We took our eyes off of this and focused on our own knowledge. And we ended up way off into the middle of a pasture. Christy and I communicated by phone. We walked up onto the road. They stopped. And when we got back to where they dropped us off, if you had looked at where we were, it wasn't that far to the finish. But we took our eyes off of where we were going and what was important and worried about where we stood. But also on that trail, there was something else that we used to do. When Drew was little, I would hold his hand whenever we would approach dangerous situations. Because I didn't want him to slip. I didn't want him to fall. I didn't want him to get hurt. And I wanted him to know that even if he did, I was there. That his father was there. You know, our father is that way. Holding our hands. It says, he will not allow your foot to slip. Your protector will not slumber. Indeed, the protector of Israel does not slumber or sleep. He will not let your foot slip. He will not cause you to go into danger. He will help you through the danger if you keep your eyes on him. It's an important reminder being communicated here that God is always with us, protecting us and basically holding our hands as we walk through life. Now, that doesn't mean we're never going to go through difficulties, because guaranteed, we're going to go through difficulties. There are trials and there are struggles. Jesus tells us that you are going to suffer in this world. But we are not suffering alone. Because we have a Heavenly Father who's right there with us. And we can take comfort in knowing that when these times come, when these difficulties come, He will be there walking with us, never leaving nor forsaking us. Throughout this text, the psalmist is emphasizing a very important idea, that God is watching over and caring for his people. When we take our eyes off of God and we focus on the world around us, we focus on the evil that is going on, we focus on the dangers that surround us, it looks like there is no hope for the world. It looks like there's no love. And people are flocking to something that gives them a glimpse of hope or love, whatever that happens to be. And oftentimes a wolf comes in sheep's clothing. Oftentimes, something is disguised as hope and love, as a sense of belonging, as a sense of redemption when it really isn't. And too many people fall victim to that when they take their eyes off of the true love, the true redemption, the true saving grace of the one and true God. It says, God does not slumber or sleep. I love that. Does not slumber or sleep, because it communicates the fact that our God is not weak and frail. When you look at our own life, you cannot go long without sleeping. You have to have rest. You have to have nourishment. Why? Because we are weak and we are frail. Our flesh is weak. And when we focus on our own bodies, our own will, it is weak. But our God is not. He does not sleep. He does not slumber. Rather, he is all strong and all powerful. See, sleep in and of itself is a sign of weakness. You and I need it. God does not. In order for us to be able to handle the tasks that are coming before us, we have to be prepared, rested, in order to attack. We need it to function. God is infinite in his power and strength. And it serves as a reminder to us just how dependent we are on him. We are not dependent on ourselves. Because if we do, we will fall. If we are dependent on him, on his love, on his grace, every single day in our lives to sustain us, things will move forward. See, we are broken, and we are hurting, and we are sinful people. Left to our own devices, we stumble and we fall because our flesh is weak. But God is in his infinite wisdom, in his infinite mercy, provided a way to free us from our selfish ways and the bondage that we've been walking around in. The question that we need to ask ourselves is, what are we putting our trust in? Are we putting our trust in ourselves? Are we putting our trust in things of this world? Are we putting our trust in God? Where's your trust? Where's your hope? Where's your faith? Where are your eyes focused? It should be on God. Are we trusting in God or in ourselves? Because if we're trusting in ourselves, we will fall victim to anxiety and fear. And that's exactly where Satan wants to keep us. Our eyes should be fixed upon the cross because everything else will fail us. It is the one thing that never will. Because of the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we are reconnected eternally with the Father. Which means there's absolutely nothing that Satan could throw at us that has any kind of eternal significance. Oh, sure, they may cause us suffering in this life. They may even take our life. But they cannot take away the everlasting life that's guaranteed in Christ Jesus. The Apostle Paul talks about this in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 55 through 57. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, death, is your victory? Where, death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. This psalm is a reminder to the Israelites of who their God is. and where their attention needs to be. And one major way in which God protects and provides for his children is through our salvation, which we receive through our faith in Christ Jesus. Paul talks about this in the book of Romans, that nothing we encounter in this world will even come close to the glory that we receive as we enter into the presence of our Lord. All of this stuff that we become so fearful about is going to fade away. The psalmist says, the Lord protects you. The Lord is a shelter right by your side. The sun will not strike you by day or the moon by night. What's being referred to there is the desert heat beating down on you, and then the dangers that arise at night. The dangers that await by the nearest corner. The dangers that await around the next valley. The Lord will protect you from all harm. He will protect your life. The Lord will protect your coming and going both now and forever. You know, in our journey, in our lives, we will have various paths that we're going to go down. We'll have several different paths, some easy, some difficult. But as believers, we have confidence in the promises we've been given because we have seen the nature and character of God through the work of his Son, Jesus Christ. See, when you look at your life, when you see who you were before Christ and you see who you are now, if you are in Christ, your life is different. It should be. Your old has passed away. The new has come. You used to hope of things of this world, and they used to let you down. And then we accept Christ as our Lord and Savior. We put our eyes on him. We focus on him. And we say, God, I'm going to go wherever you send me. I'm going to do whatever you call me to do. You are my Lord and Savior. You are everything to me. I'm going to read your word every day. I'm going to pray every day. I'm going to spend intimate time with you every single moment. And as life typically does, as we typically do, we slip away from that. And why do we do that? Because we hear a tragic story. We see something taking place and think, man, there's so much evil in this world. And we start to drift our eyes off of Christ and onto the world. Remember, Satan hates to lose. And anytime God is on the move, Satan increases his attack because he hates to lose. And so as more and more come to the kingdom, there's going to be more and more evil. And our world is right now experiencing two things. You look around and you see revivals popping up left and right. You see people coming to Christ left and right. You see people stopping and praying. You see people coming over to people who are sitting in a restaurant and going, hey, I'm so glad that you're taking the time to pray. You have waitresses and waiters that are coming up to bring something to the table, and they go, oh, I want to join in on this prayer. Used to, that didn't happen. Now we're having a lot of that going on. But at the same time that these revivals are popping up, what else do you see? You see train derailments. You see all kinds of evil being spread throughout that. You hear people talking about, well, it's because of this, it's because of this. Just accidents happen. Yes, sometimes they can be avoided. And there's messes to clean up and there's people to take care of. I'm not trying to downplay it. What I am saying is that oftentimes we attack a situation because of the evil surrounding it, instead of focusing on the good that is taking place. We look at accidents like what happened in Ohio. We look at natural disasters like what took place in Kentucky. And we see things that are happening on the coastlines all around our country. We see things all over our country, all over our world. We see earthquakes. We see everything else. And one of the things that so many people do is they focus on the negative with it instead of looking and going, how are people being loved? How are people being helped? And broadcasting that. Keeping our eyes on Christ. Keeping our eyes on the love and grace that is being shown through the actions of others. In our world, in our community, we see a lot of evil. We see a lot of hurt. We see a lot of despair. We see people looking for some kind of answer, something to belong to, something to feel loved, something to say I'm important. And there's only one that gives us all of that, and that's God. And as Christians, we know that. And as Christians, we feel it in our heart. As Christians, it's our job to go and to share that message with others. God has put us on mission, and that is to share the gospel message with any and everybody that we can. Go and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and I will be with you always, even to the end. See, that's another reminder of what the psalmist is saying right here. God is always with us. He will protect your coming and going, both now and forever. You know, music is one of those powerful communication tools. It can build somebody up or it can tear somebody down. And one of the things that's buried inside music that does the most harm or the most good is our words. If you strip away all the notes and focus on the words that are being expressed, if you strip away all the musical instruments and just focus on the words, what are they saying? What are they saying? The psalmist is saying, I lift my eyes toward the mountains. Where will my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to slip. Your protector will not slumber. Indeed, the protector of Israel does not slumber or sleep. The Lord protects you. The Lord is a shelter right by your side. The sun will not strike you by day or moon by night. The Lord will protect you from all harm. He will protect your life. The Lord will protect your coming and going, both now and forever. Put those in modern day words. Put those in something that we can relate to. Today, I'm going through a trial in my life. I've got a hard decision to make. I've got a struggle. I've got an addiction that I have. I've got something in my life that is tearing my life apart. Where am I going to get some help, some relief? God. God will be there for me. He will help me through this. He will carry me through to the other side. He's not going to allow me to fail. He's not going to allow me to fall. As a matter of fact, he's going to carry me every step of the way if I will let him, if I look to him, because God is always there. Sometimes I'm the one that fails, and I'm the one that drifts off, but God never does. He's always there. Indeed, the protector of Israel does not sleep or slumber. In other words, he is not weak. He is strong. I am weak, and I am dependent on him. He is where my hope and my strength comes from. The Lord protects you. The Lord is my shelter. That's right. He protects me. He is with me. He gives me the armor, the shield to fight off Satan's attacks. But I have to stay with him. I have to stay focused in him. I have to stay studying in his word. I have to spend time in prayer. I have to have that intimate relationship. And if I do, then I'm protected. When Satan throws something at me, I can just combat it with what's actually happening. You know, Jesus was tempted in the wilderness. And Satan would throw passages and say, well, if you're truly the Son of God, do this, because that's what Scripture says. And Jesus says, no, 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 Scripture actually says this. It's when we're frail, it's when we're weak, it's when we're not engaged with God that things happen. That's how Satan got a hold of Eve in the garden. Scripture says this. No, actually, it says this. If I stay with God, he protects me. There is no dangers. There is nothing that Satan could throw at me. The Lord will protect you from all harm. He will protect your life. My life is in Christ. I have Christ as my Lord and Savior. My eternal life is taken care of. There's nothing that can harm me. What do I have to fear? Nothing. Because I'm in Christ. He will protect me. He will deliver me. He will protect your coming and going both now and forever. I'm in Christ. I never have to worry about anything. Once you're in Christ, you're always in Christ. Once you're saved, you're always saved. And there's nothing that this world will ever do to take that away.